Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. This time on the program, we're telling stories about animals and our connection with animals with nature journalist and author Richard Louv. His new book is Our Wild Calling, How Connecting with Animals Can Transform Our Lives and Save Theirs. Richard says when he asks people to describe their encounters and relationships with animals, wild or domestic, everyone seems to have a story.
When he was a kid, he stuttered, had a terrible stuttering problem, to the point where he would droop from other human beings as a little boy. And then his father took him to the zoo. He had a relationship with a jaguar, and he would talk to the jaguar, and he found his words coming, his stutter lifted.
It's Richard Louv and our connection with animals.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
Richard, it's a pleasure to have you on the program.
Thanks.
You're really encouraging us in your book to listen and to communicate with animals. Is that the right way to put it?
Yeah. The recent years, there's been a huge amount of research, or at least more than there had been, about animal communication, not only within a species, but between species and with us. And there's a lot more going on there than we usually think.
Yeah. You asked everyone you know, it sounds like, and experts as well, to relate their encounters with animals, both domestic and and wild. And what were some of the ones that stuck out to you?
One of them is early in the book, and it's a guy named Paul Dayton, who's one of the most famous oceanographers among oceanographers in the world. And he's in his 80s now, but when he was a young man, he was on the bottom of the ocean one day, and he was poking around looking for samples. And he felt something very large. He just knew it was there come above him. And that's usually not a good sign, and it stopped. And at the risk of anthropomorphizing it, he looked up and he saw a giant
octopus.
About 12-foot span octopus. And he said it decided he was a clam, and it came down and it got him. And he said people think those tentacles are soft, and they're not. They're very hard, and they're very strange. These tentacles have a lot of photons in them. The brains of an octopus are distributed throughout the body, and the arms have parts of those. So, in a sense, this octopus was getting to know him really well, almost seeing him. And about the time that he realized that he was in the grasp of this thing, he realized he was running out of oxygen. And so, with the last of his energy, he pushed off the bottom of the ocean. And he and the octopus went up and up and up in the column of water, and as they went up, the octopus moved around his body. He could feel the razor sharp beak of the octopus running around his neck until he had eye contact with the thing.
And they were looking at each other.
They were looking at each other. And they went up and up, and at some point he did what prey often do, like the gazelle in the mouth of the lion. He relaxed. And the octopus kind of relaxed, and they were looking at each other. About that time, he hit the surface. He's out of air, and he rips off his mask. He's looking down at the octopus right under the surface. And what does he do?
He chased after it.
Yeah, the octopus turns into like the shape of a space shuttle, as he puts it, and starts going down into the dark. And he turns around and chases it down into the dark. I said, Paul, why did you do that? And he has no clue other than this was a kind of a life-changing moment for him. And he doesn't really have the words like many of us who had similar experiences.
It's funny because I had two experiences just this past weekend that I probably wouldn't have given much thought to if I had not been reading your book. And my experiences were, we were up in Los Alamos, and here comes a deer into the vineyard. And then another one. And it was, I guess, a family of deer, and they were probably 100 yards off, and we were all staring at the deer, and they were staring back at us, and I suspect wondering if we were a threat, and we just kept staring at them and sort of whispering to ourselves, and they looked at us, and then they returned to whatever they're doing in the vineyard, and then they seemed to get just closer and closer, as if, okay, you guys aren't threats to us, we'll just hang out and do our thing. So the other experience was this family came with a dog that I had never met before. And at one point in the afternoon, I was taking a brief nap. And as I was falling asleep, the door pushed open, and I felt on the bed this presence. And I looked up, and the dog was standing over me, right next to me.
Wow.
And just stared at me as if, again, ascribing his thoughts to me as if to say, is it okay if I hang out with you? And I sort of, you know, spoke to him in a friendly voice. And he curled up, and we both fell asleep next to each other.
Yeah.
And I found great joy in that particular moment.
Right.
And is that what you're talking about in terms of what we get out of it? Or is that too small a story to describe what you're...
I don't think any of the interpretations of these stories is too small. There's a lot there. There's a lot of ways to... like I said, it's tough to find the words. And this book is an effort to find those words. One of the issues that I deal with, and by the way, I want to tell you, you told about this dog. I tell the story about my dog when I was a kid. It was a collie, and I spent a lot of time in the woods. My parents didn't know where I was, but my dog did. And his name was Banner. And in the book, I say that Banner saw me the way I wanted to be seen, and he expected me to live up to what he saw. I always had the feeling that Banner taught me some ethics. I thought, that's, you know, Banner, my dog was from a long line of wolves that probably had some ethical behavior that we might call ethical behavior before primates.
And what were some of those ethical behaviors?
Well, again, you know, I'll plead guilty to romanticizing my dog.
Mm-hmm.
But I watched him protect younger dogs. This is back in the day when there weren't fences in the neighborhood, and he would protect younger dogs. He hated our cat, but they'd go out in the morning, and the cat would be between his leg, and Banner would be looking around. And he ran up he did lassie things. He ran up the street one time. I was out in the front yard, and I saw him tackle in midair this big dog that was about to attack a woman that had just stepped out of her door with her tiny little Pekingese dog. And she came down and thanked us about that. He pulled my little brother out of the road once by his diapers, and he worried a lot. My mother said she always knew when Banner was worrying because his head was hot. And many of the people, as they told their stories about their animals that they grew up with, the other animals they lived with, learned more about that experience through the telling of that story. They felt it even more than they had before because they told it.
Coming up.
When he was a kid, he stuttered, had a terrible stuttering problem, to the point where he would droop from other human beings as a little boy. And then his father took him to the zoo. He had a relationship with a jaguar in a cage that it turned its back on people, except for Alan, this little boy.
Because he would just sit there.
He would just sit there. And the jaguar would come up to the and look at him. And he would talk to the jaguar. And he found his words coming, his stutter lifted.
It's more of my conversation with Richard Louv when we come back. I think so many of us who have had pets feel like we're communicating with our pet.
Mm-hmm.
And I wish that my pet would communicate back to me. I know that's never going to happen, but it would be nice to know exactly what's on his mind or her mind.
In the book, I talk about the oldest language, and this is where it precedes human language. There are folks doing work on the eco-psychologists looking at animal communication, and they... one in particular talks about nature language, and I talk about the oldest language. This predates verbal language. It's certain behaviors that seem to cross species, cross the line between some species. Squirrels and birds work together. The squirrels
right.
know the sounds, the alarm sounds of the birds, and the birds know the alarm sounds of the squirrels. One of the themes in the book, and this has to do with that need for that kind of communication with other people who are animals, as well as other animals who are not people or not human beings. There is in the world now an epidemic of loneliness, of human loneliness, and medical folks are talking about the urgency of recognizing that. They're saying that loneliness, social isolation, may be responsible soon for more diseases than obesity, and more mortality, early mortality than obesity. Mm-hmm. And it's not just because we're all on Facebook. There's something else going on there. And one of the suggestions I make in the book is that this is species loneliness, that our loneliness from each other, and it only gets worse with antisocial media, that is rooted in something much deeper, which is species loneliness. We're lonely for other species. We don't want to be alone in the world, in the universe. The studies of urban parks show that the ones that are the best for human psychological health are the parks with the highest biodiversity. Mm. I don't think that's an accident. We are hungry, desperate to not feel alone in the universe. Why else would we look for Bigfoot?
Yeah.
Why else would we look for intelligent life on other planets when it may not be a good idea to find it, you know?
Yeah. You say in your book that there are two reasons that we need to further explore our personal relationships with other animals. One is human health and well-being, which is what you're talking about. And then the other is the current condition of the world, as you suggest. You say some scientists describe what we're experiencing today as the sixth mass mm-hmm. extinction. Mm-hmm. Describe that.
And there's a lot of evidence that's going on. I mean, there was just a story just the other day. The New York Times was reporting on a science journal study that was reported there that says that within the last 50 years, just since 1970, a third of birds in the United States, in North America, have disappeared, are gone. And that's just one example of the extinctions that are going on around us. As we've lost contact with that life that we've been describing, that is indescribable in some ways, I think that environmentalism, conservation have suffered. We cannot make the case to protect other species unless we love them. We don't have to love all of them, but to have that feeling of connection that we are part of a larger family.
You talk about, or we bring up this mountain lion idea, and it reminds me of the situation that Alan Rabinowitz found himself in, described as the Indiana Jones of wildlife science. He's in Belize, and he's all about jaguars. He has a passion for jaguars, and he's in the jungle to see if he can go find one. And at the end of the day, he doesn't encounter it. He decides to turn back because he's losing light, and right there on the path in front of him is a jaguar.
Yeah.
And tell us what happened next.
Well, the worst thing you could do with a mountain lion or certainly a jaguar is run away. It triggers their chase, you know, just pull something across the rug for a cat and you see what happens. Or to sit down or to bend over to show, to allow the dominance of the other animal, to be submissive to that animal, kind of invites trouble. He sat down and he's had decades of experience with jaguars. He doesn't know why he did that.
Because what he should do is make himself larger.
That's right.
And slowly walk away.
That's right.
But he didn't do that, knowing, despite the fact that of all the people who would know that, it would be him.
That's right.
He sat down.
And the jaguar, if I got the story right, sat down.
Yeah.
And they looked at each other for a while. And finally, the jaguar moseyed off into the jungle. Now, just as there are rogue animals that do bad things, that they're not supposed to be doing bad things, there are rogue animals that don't do bad things in a certain moment in which these things. His earlier story, is even better. His, when he was a kid, Alan Rabinowitz, who died recently while I was writing the book, he stuttered, had a terrible stuttering mm-hmm. problem, to the point where he would droop from other human beings as a little boy. Then he started to learn that he could talk to his hamster. His hamster would listen to him. And then his father took him to the zoo. I think it was the Bronx Zoo one day. And they kept going back because he had a relationship with a jaguar in a cage that it turned its back on people, except for Alan, this little boy.
Because he would just sit there.
He would just sit there. And the jaguar would come up to the and look at him. And he would talk to the jaguar. And he found his words coming, his stutter lifted. And he said he'd been to a psychiatrist. At that point, they had all kinds of draconian things that they did for kids that stuttered. None of that worked for him. It just drove him deeper into himself because it was all about their expectations of him. The jaguar had no expectations. And again, it was the eye contact. It was, you know, feeling something between him and the, and he grew more comfortable. He lost his stutter for the most part. And he made a vow to that jaguar that when he grew up, he would protect jaguars. And he did. He grew up and he started this this program that is throughout Central America, South America, even the United States, to protect jaguar habitat.
Still ahead, if we continue down the path that we're on, more isolation, not interacting with other species, driving out animals from our urban areas, where does that leave us in 5, 10, 20, 100 years?
When it's just down to us, some of our domestic animals, livestock, and that's it. That not the age of man, but the age of loneliness.
We're back with Richard Louv in just a moment. If we continue down the path that we're on, more isolation, not interacting with other species, driving out animals from our urban areas, where does that leave us in 5, 10, 20, 100 years?
E.O. Wilson, the great scientist at Harvard, who talked about the biophilia hypothesis, he talks about the, you know, perhaps have heard the term the Anthropocene, which is the geological age we're entering right now, in which it's all human-centered, Anthropocene. And he describes that as potentially, when it's just down to us, some of our domestic animals, livestock, and that's it. He calls that not the age of man, but the age of loneliness.
Hmm.
This book, what I've written, is to propose an alternative to that. Others have too. In Australia, Glenn Albrecht talks about the symbiocene as an alternative to where we're at now, in which we've learned to live in symbiosis with other life. And I call it, instead of the age of loneliness, the age of connectedness. Ultimately, that road away from other life leads to a kind of loneliness that is filled with pathology and sadness.
Hmm.
But there is another road, another trail.
And let me end on one more personal story that you tell at the beginning of your book, and ask you to tell me what it means. And that is that walk you were taking in Kodiak Island in Alaska. And you're walking along, and you come upon face to face with a fox. Is it a fox?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Big fox.
A big fox.
I think Kodiak Island has the biggest foxes in the world.
So you're walking along and you come face to face with this fox and you lock eyes with the fox. What was that about? And what does that story mean to you?
Well, first, on that island, I was at a lodge. My son was working as a guide at this lodge, and I was on my way from the cabin up, the cabin around the lodge, up to the lodge. And I was actually counting my money because my son had been my guide, and I was going to give him a tip. You're supposed to give a tip, so I was kind of. I should have been looking up because Kodiak brown bears, the largest of the grizzlies, wander through that camp, and you really got to be careful. I wasn't, and I was counting my money, walking around, and all of a sudden I stop, and there's this fox, and it's looking at me. It's all black, a black fox, and it's got these eyes that look like stars in the universe. I mean, it's intense. It's just standing there. And I stop and I'm looking at it and I'm wondering, is this is this rabid? Is fox dangerous? We just looked at each other for a long time, and it's the same kind of thing. You look into the eyes of these things, and I'm not saying I knew what was in those eyes. In fact, I had no clue what was in those eyes. Looking in those eyes was like looking into the universe. It was like, these are other worlds. This is a parallel universe. How often do you get to look into a parallel universe? And I thought, well, okay, I'm going to take a step. And I took a step, and the fox kind of moved away. I said, you want to go to the lodge with me? And I walk up toward the lodge, and the fox is walking next to me. Now, I asked, do they feed the foxes there? Was this one? They said, no, we don't feed the foxes. But it went with me until it didn't, until it veered off and disappeared into the grass. I don't know what it was about that. Again, you know, I could be accused of reading too much into that. I could also be accused of not reading enough into it, because I think that the mystery is the point there. That encounter with another universe, a parallel being, was very moving to me and puzzling. And that's the first story, because that, you know, that's where the book essentially came from. Mm. What in the world is that about?
Yeah. Well, what is it about? Folks will have to read Our Wild Calling, How Connecting with Animals Can Transform Our Lives and Save Theirs, to find out. Richard, thanks very much.
Oh, thanks.
All right. If you'd like to hear more of my conversation with Richard Louv, I hope you'll check out the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast. We have more than 170 conversations in our archives, and you can listen to any one of them right now. And don't forget, we always post all of our programs to YouTube after they air on TV. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.